gave this talk on behalf of the EDWAY's WP4 team, which is a bigger team, as you will see, but I speak. I give you first an introduction about the project, and I talk behind, or more beyond the project, giving you a general vision and a general agenda, which is basically initially my agenda, but now more and more people from this community that this project is from have understood and that we follow. And I will talk about the Earth System Data middleware, and I give you some performance numbers. Primarily, I think it's the high-level thoughts that matter. So I talked already about what is EDWAY before. It's the Center of Excellence in Simulation and Weather and Climate in Europe, which aims to ask the demonstrators simulations that run at highest affordable resolution. And I/O is, of course, a part in it, which is how I basically participate in this project. So it has 20 partners from 9 countries and 35 supporting institutions. Here you see an image, a group photo of the EDWAY kickoff. Just to point out, this is a sufficiently big crowd. So the challenges in climate and weather in general are that the scientists have to program efficient workflows, they have to analyze this data efficiently that they produce. They have to organize these large data sets. Then they have to ensure reproducibility of these workflows and ensure the data is safely stored and can be later used again. And of course, they have to deal with the future compute and storage needs to adjust their codes that are typically long living, 10 years and more, to this changing hardware landscape. And in my personal opinion, right, scientists should focus on point one, which is their workflows, and point two, which is their analysis. They shouldn't deal with anything else here on the list, because these are more technical questions. So if I talk about a workflow in climate and weather, on the right side, you see one workflow representation. Scientists have developed a solution, for example, the SILC workflow processing engine, I'd say, which allows them to run and repeat experiments. And what is special about the experiments is that they often have to do a similar type of operations over different periods of time. For example, when you do a climate simulation, often the result that you are interested in, it's the same result, the same data product for January or February and March and so on. Sometimes it might be different. So they have these workflows, they are specified in a configuration file, together with the task to execute. And scientists have, when they have this kind of workflow, they have typically these tasks in their mind. They don't think about the I/O dependencies, which ultimately make up, of course, this graph. But our role is, concerns me, particularly that scientists should not worry where the data is. They shouldn't think about the data. They should think about the data dependency, though. And why is this so important? Because in the data center, so we see already we have different types of storage devices. As shared storage, we have node storage. We want to go to different facilities, remote facilities, to the cloud. And we want to exploit all the storages, and this means vendor, between different vendors. It shouldn't be just one GPFS solution, for example, that you have in a data center that makes it to use SSDs, main memory, NVM, local NVM, for example, and hard disk drive solutions. It should be a solution that works across boundaries. We want to be able to use all the storage technologies concurrently without using migration to migrate data afterwards. And it would be, in a perfect world, I think, looking at a data center perspective, I'd love to have a data center, right, which has some storage deployed, and then you have monitoring systems that tell you, oh, I have a problem with this type of access pattern. Access pattern is a problem, and to fix it, I propose you add this storage technology to your environment. And then you say, yeah, is it actually paying off? You do some kind of simulation, right? And you say, yeah, it actually is beneficial for my data center operational costs. So I buy this solution, I put it in, like I add here burst buffers, for example, or tapes might be sometimes paying off. And you put this in, the scientist doesn't have to change anything, and the workflow just exploits this technology. That would be my dream of an environment, still a dream. So talking about the vision, My long-term vision, or the general long-term vision, is the full separation of concerns. The scientists should think about their scientific metadata, which talks about what is this data actually meaning to them. They should declare these workflows, which includes everything like the data life cycle, how long to preserve data. The value of data, I think, is very important. You should give, of course, permissions, stuff like that. Sometimes you want to annotate, interestingly, expectations about a workflow. How long should it take? Like you could say, for instance, well, I'm going on a vacation 2 weeks, and you know, in 1 month's time, I want to start writing a paper. So please run this workflow such that it's completed in a month. That would be nice. And then the system could make the best choice in terms of cost efficiency and so forth. But of course, you have those workflows that you know in advance what you want to do. And then at the same time, you have this more explorative research type of workflows where you need, as a scientist, you need to adapt, and the system needs to adapt to your use cases. So you work workflows on the fly, you use interactive analysis like visual analytics to process your data, and then you wanted a workflow like computational steering and so on adapts to your needs. That would be really nice. But this is what I want as a user, if I would be a user, so to speak. Then I'm a programmer. As a programmer of models and tools, well, I want to decide about the most appropriate API to use for a specific tool. Like, is it NetCDF? Should I look at table CSV files? Those kind of decisions I want to make. I want to think about computation, like doing compute, having some kind of analytics that I want to ship into my data-driven computation. But I don't want to care where and how computation and storage should take place. There should be a runtime system that makes decisions. Finally, decisions by the compute and storage system, infrastructure, runtime system slash, should do how to store the data, how to format this data into file formats, how to manage the storage space. And we want to do data transformations, replication factors, and so on the fly. So like when I store my data, right, the system makes a decision to make a layout, but when I read it, not necessarily this layout is beneficial. So the system should make data transformations on the fly instead of me as a user to make a decision like, oh, now I want to access this as a time series, a certain spatial point. Now I should reformat my data. No, you shouldn't do that at all. You should look at your data, and the system should manage the storage space. And then the system must, of course, schedule those compute, storage, and analysis jobs somehow, hiding where they run those parts of this computation. So you could run them always on a client or server infrastructure. You could run them actually in the network, for example, with the modern network interfaces from Mellanox. They could run partially on the cloud, and actually last steps of the workflow could run actually on your laptop. I call this concept fluid computing because the computation and the data flows through our architecture agnostic of kind of vendor, I would say. Good. Okay, I was giving you a generic brand of vision now. Now let's talk a bit more about the smarter climate and weather workflows in the future. Well, it says 2020 plus. Well, we have 2020, but even in further future. So we have typically in those workflows, we have acquisition instruments like satellite data. We also see in the future more and more, we already see currently, that Internet of Things devices are included, particularly pressure information from mobile devices beneficial in a lot of countries because they would be at a chance to improve the accuracy of weather prediction a lot. So this data needs to be fed in over the edge to some HPC sites, maybe some local data centers where you store data, and then you run ensembles of forecasts or simulations. And right now, right, from these forecasts and simulations, typically the user would specify before the application runs what data it should produce and the periodicity the data is produced, and this data is then stored on your storage system. This is something that we do right now, but instead it is much smarter, we believe, that the data, instead of storing this data at such fixed intervals, you have machine learning components and users connected to this process that make decisions. This is an interesting pattern, for example. I'm interested in typhoons, whatever. And you make those annotations, and the system then figures out, if it sees interesting patterns, it would figure those out and trigger a data reduction process. For example, when you run similar simulations, which often happens in weather. So you perturb the input slightly, you run slightly different patterns, and then you run ensembles like 10 or 100 times the same simulation with different input pattern to then make a likely prediction of what the weather will be. Of these 100 runs, you could imagine that I'm only interested in maybe the minimum, the maximum, the mean, and two or three examples that really represent this data. So I store maybe just 10% of the data, which is this data reduction process, but only again if machine learning detects those patterns. And if a user figures out something is going wrong, they want on the fly to connect using this kind of in situ approach to the data and perform further experience, further analysis on this data. At the end, right, you have data here in the repository where you can then run further training offline if you need. And from this data that's also generated often that you see in particular in weather forecasting, you have certain products that you always need to produce because they need to be presented in the in TV, for instance. And this data that gets populated using typically some kind of web services. But you could also imagine that the web service, a user requests something, a data product that doesn't yet exist, and then it would trigger automatically this framework here to produce the data the user asked for and store this data. There's a lot more that I could say to it, but I gave you in a nutshell the idea. I think, you know, we surely move into this area where we combine these capabilities of the users to scientists to analyze data into the simulation. And that will lead to this data reduction that is actually needed, because otherwise in climate and weather, it is enormous. So these are also the parts that we are interested in EasyWays. Let me talk about one particular product of EasyWays, which is called the Earth System Data Middleware, which is an approach basically towards this vision that I talked for you. And one design goal of the ESDM mentioned is that it relaxes the access semantics and it's really tailored to the scientific data generation, but at the same time, it also allows this analysis. Most important from this perspective of IODC is that the operation, the layouting is site-specific. Now, from a data center perspective, you can define how should data be placed based on the infrastructure you have, stripping away this tedious task from the user to make such placement decisions and allowing you, like I mentioned before, this idea that you can make the decision how to place data in such an infrastructure that should depend more on the site instead of a user which can make wrong decisions and likely does. Okay, how does this work? We have one interface that is below NetCDF. NetCDF can interact pretty much with it. We have one layout component that makes placement decisions, and it can use arbitrary site-specific backends, file systems, object storage, and what have you. And from this technology, instead of just making one decision to say, I store all my data of one data set into object storage or on one file system, instead you can make select subsets of this data and store it on different storage technologies, even gaining parallelism by using technologies. So we have the site-specific backends and mappings. And if you ever need a canonical format, well, you would go to the site boundary where you can convert it, for example, to NetCDF, which is a typical API. Here's a transitional storage stack for large-scale ensembles. So we have the applications, which are one, you could imagine, one weather simulation with slightly different parameters, run 10 times. Then we have this XIOS, climate weather domain-specific, I would say, burst buffer solution that runs on a subset of the nodes that gathers the data from the application. It understands what the data is about, the semantics, the user side, and it allows some kind of data reductions. And underneath, we can, for instance, the NetCDF API as a transitional approach, and then ESDM, which makes this mapping to system-specific storage devices. The overall software landscape in EasyWays includes additional components on the Python level. We have also additional software like ZenSL, and we also deal with big data tools like Ophidia, and also in situ visualization ParaView, which will be integrated in this kind of in a bigger ecosystem. ESDM is basically underneath here, but I don't spend too much time here. Instead, I want to mention quickly that we have a couple of storage plugins like POSIX, of course, Clovis. We had one for DDN SWAS solution. We have one for COVIS in-memory system. We have one for PMEM, which I will present some results. And we have at the moment a POSIX metadata backend, showed to be quite scalable, surprisingly. But we investigate also NoSQL solutions to put on top of the metadata. It can be used very easily, ESDM, so you create the ESDM configuration with store locations, then you run MKFS pretty much. So this is, you can compare this a little bit to PLFS, which also has this approach to you reuse some existing storage locations. And then inside your netcd application, all you need to do is you add a new prefix, ESDM prefix, and then it would detect data is stored in ESDM. So this way you can inject, for example, data using the netcdf tools, like copy an existing netcdf file into ESDM prefix, and then I can dump, use the netcdf dump to dump me the headers information. I can copy data out of ESDM, and you can use it from XiOS again, which also has it, which uses, this one uses an XML specification. You can specify the file name is ESDM, and then it kind of generates the data and stores it in ESDM. Okay, let me show you one, I would say one interesting aspect I want to point out for discussion. So when we have here a modification of a shallow water model, which traditionally separates compute phases in IO. So basically you could imagine every 10th IO phase, I have one IO phase. So you do, you have a loop, right? And you check if my, if this is an IO phase, I do after my computation, I do IO. And the IO here works by storing data column-wise using netcdf. So we NC put variable float, a subset of the data on this series. So we see a lot of calls, one per column. So with ESDM, we have an additional API here, which is the write stream API. So you can say, I know at the end, I will have written, you know, this subdomain, this first domain is actually time. So I will have written an, the whole X and Y dimension. And then you just have these two loops inside the application that iterate somehow over this data. And then you package, you store the data inside this stream. So now the interesting part here is, well, you might say this is a lot of overhead to get for each individual value. It is true, but this is, first of all, this is optimized in that sense that this is a macro, and this macro actually under the hood, what it does, it triggers the IO, may allow for further post-processing, like this workflow processing analytics, once the data is ready. So if this dimension would be very large, you know, X and Y would be very huge, you could imagine that every 5 kilobytes or every 10 kilobytes of data, this call, this macro here actually invokes to trigger in the background some kind of IO storing of data and the post-processing of this 10 kilobytes of data, but the user doesn't have to realize how it actually works, right? So there is no async or any kind of opens. And why is this interesting? Because you could imagine using domain-specific languages that, well, I do just my normal computation, and whenever a data point that I want to store is ready, I just call this function to make it, to put it into this buffer. That way you don't have to later read it again, right? Because memory throughput is precious. If I can reduce the memory pressure, I have more time for my application. And I think it's a very natural way of doing this. And at the end, of course, we have to commit the write stream to basically finish up. That's one way how we redesigned this. We have also, and there's also in the first implementation of this, of course, but we also have been designing workflow extensions. So in this environment where we have Silk, and Silk runs a scheduler like Slurm, for example, you read this config file, and Silk would generate a lot of Slurm jobs together with the right dependencies. Now we enrich this with the ESDM IO scheduler. This is very loosely coupled on purpose. Research component. So it needs an additional IO config file, which basically gives us information about, you know, every output. What do you know about this output? Is it, what is the value of it? What is the sizes and so on? And also it knows about the ESDM config file. And based on this, together with the workflow information that it gets from this workflow config file, it can make decisions like where should I place this data initially and so on. And these decisions are communicated in this more complicated framework by injecting it into the script, a change to the file name, a regular file name, which then is passed again inside the ESDM to make the decision. So what can we do with it? What is the benefit? So we decouple the decision making about the storage locations from the scientists actually. And those hints, they can hopefully be used to prefer local storage, like in DKC, for example, they have a lot of node local storage. And You use, for example, IME to pin data to cache if you have knowledge about a future workflow, right? Instead of assuming something about the workflow like we learned from the last talk, we actually want to know what the workflow will be like and make decisions accordingly. And when you have multiple jobs that need, one job generates the data and the other one reads the data again, you could co-locate them on Node, reading it again using some nice Slurm extension from NextGen.io, actually, that we will. And you could also make initial data allocations better. Okay, now I want to show you some results, which is from ESDM itself, because it must be performant, right? And I use the DKZ Mistral supercomputer, and I have 100, 200, 500 nodes on measurement. Don't worry about the data. Most interestingly, I'd say, let's look at the 500 node case. What we see when we use ESPM with Lustre, so we have two file systems, the DKRZ, Lustre 01 and Lustre 02. Then we get this performance, about 150 gigabytes per second. By the way, this is close to IOR performance, which isn't here on the slide for population, for not polluting it, but it's close. And then once we use Lustre both, which means one ESDM configuration which uses both Lustres, and there's still room for optimization effect, you can see that we get better performance, you know, 180 gigabyte. So that's already nice, which can speed up some IOs. And for read, it's actually similar. And those, by the way, large, what does large mean versus non-large? It means the way the data is distributed between those two file systems, decision making by ESDM. Of course, that applies also for smaller configurations. And we can see with about 100 nodes, we get almost similar performance. Reason is that DKZ has about 118 storage OSTs. So since once we have more than 100 nodes, well, there isn't too much improvement or on another service. So to show you also a potential that we have when we run on node local storage, here's a comparison actually of TempFS versus IOR. So when we use our ESDM on TempFS or if we use IOR, and we see when we go for 500 nodes, we see for different numbers of processes per node, we see that with 8, you can get about 3 terabytes a second. And IOR, well, it's slightly better here. For lower PPN, it's actually quite similar. But there's still room for optimizations. And for read, you see also that ESDM could also, on TempFS, could also achieve 3 terabytes a second. So that is also for some workloads that have a lot of more randomized IO, sometimes beneficial. And it shows when you go for 500 nodes, right, and you would have good node local storage, having 3 terabytes or comparison 150 gigabyte, that makes a difference and can speed up the run. So one final result, which is on the next gen IO prototype here, measured with just 4 nodes. So we were at a nice workshop organized by EPCC, and so next gen IO prototype, it has Optane from Intel, and you can use it natively as a POSIX interface using the POSIX file system on top of it. Then we see low performance in this case for write and low, well, better performance for read, but not so good. Once you use an optimized version now of ESDM, so there was a port made of that actually understands the topology inside the node, which is dual socket configuration. In this case, you can see that the performance goes up a lot. So we get 50 gigabyte a second for write, this configuration, and for read, more than 100. And on the right side, I show you this kind of number here is a hero number, what you could achieve when you run a proper benchmark, but without doing the metadata overhead in ESDM. But I was still surprised because we basically get 50% of efficiency with just a very simple port. And this is much better than, you know, doing it totally naively, not adjusting anything using POSIX. And also interestingly, TempFS performance here is actually not much higher than this configuration, and it's lower when you do the optimal, when you would do an optimal layout. So Optane is actually faster than TempFS. Probably the reason is, again, the optimizations they do, while TempFS is built on a much older software stack, I would say. Okay, there have been a couple of recent improvements in ESDM, and we won't go much through it. We have included compression and so on, and we built CAM prototypes for supporting post-processing analytics and in situ visualization. they are not yet in the main code, so to speak. To ramp up, ESDM is a performance portable I/O system that utilizes heterogeneous storage. It's backward compatible with NetCDF, supporting Python workflows. And in this workflow approach, we try to use node local storage better and any kind of heterogeneous storage. And a couple of activities that we have nearly completed and will complete soon is this a comparison of a flexible chunking that we do with ESDM. So we have basically a shared nothing way of doing the write phases compared to a chunking approach from HDF5, comparing it to a fixed chunking like NetCDF or HDF5. And we also do some optimizations where we, during read process, actually we remap the data to transform it to a better layout, such that when you do this kind of read operation again, that you get better performance. So that concludes my talk, and let's see if we have any questions. I see none. So, well, of course, we can always discuss later. So, like I said, basically, I think there's a lot of high-level stuff here, visions part, and I wanted to tie it a little bit to ongoing activities in ESDM, and that's why I showed you also this evaluation. Right, a very good question. So if you have a tool that doesn't use, so ask what happens if you access data that was created with ESDM using a tool that doesn't use ESDM. Well, if you use the normal NetCDF stuff, where was it? The normal NetCDF stack. Yeah, we have a patched version of NetCDF, so you can use Python scripts even to use the NetCDF implementation. It runs. So we have here, I showed you here these tools, NC copy, NC dump, and NC copy. Basically, NC view as well works. Just link it against ESDM library and it works. Of course, it won't potentially get the best performance, but that's kind of what we try to elaborate. We try to provide a level of compatibility, but at the same time, we really try to test new concepts, new in regard to what the scientists do at the moment, like these write streams, which would require a change in your application. But what would be a real benefit needs to be always compared to a naive, historically written application, legacy application, to really show cases where it pays off to do it. Similar with the workflows, right? There will be cases when such an extension will be beneficial. Sometimes it's beneficial to do it, on the fly, if some smarter system detects the patterns and does something. Sometimes it might be really pay off if we know a lot about this workflow. So we see. Okay, so that